In this video, I'm going to show a method for calculating percents and a method I consider to be best practice. And the practice is, as quick as you can, change the percent to a decimal. And it's easy to change percents to decimals. And another way of saying it is, before calculating with percents, change them to decimals. And again, I remind you, it's easy to change percents to decimals. And a third way of saying it is, it's much easier to calculate with decimals than with percents. And I've repeated this message three different ways, and I'm going to leave it on the screen just to try to convince you that this is a better way to do calculations with percents. And I'm going to do six different examples, different types of percent questions. And if you wish, you might want to pause the video now and work out these questions on your own. And then after you've got your answers, resume it and compare your answer and your method to mine. Now, the first example is 23% of 200 euros. And as quick as you can, you change 23% into a decimal. And you do that by dividing 23 by 100, and it becomes not 0.23. Dividing by 100 is very easy. You just move the decimal point two places to the right. It's understood to be behind a number if there's no decimal point in it, and then you move it two places to the right and it comes in front of the two. And that's as quick as you can. You change it to a decimal. Now, you notice in this calculation we have a division and a multiplication. I'm going to show you some other methods for doing this in just a moment. And when we do the multiplication, we get this answer. Let's double check that on our calculator. If you do not 0.23 times 200, you get 46. Now, in this question, we have a division and we have a multiplication. We can do these operations in different orders, and you may have learned to do percents by doing these in a different order, and let me just show you what happens when you do it in different orders. As long as we always divide by the 100 and we multiply the other numbers, we're going to get the same answer in the end. Now, if the first thing that you do is you take the 200 and divide by 100, you'll get 2, and then you multiply that by 23, you get 46, just like we did here. Now, this makes a bit of sense because you're dividing the 200 euros by 100 to find out that 1% of 200 euros is 2 euros, and we want 23%, so you multiply what the 1% is by 23 to get 46 euros. So this makes a bit of sense, but I think my way is better, and I'll be showing you why I think it's better. Now, another way of doing it is you can first multiply the 200 by 23 to get 4,600, and then finally divide by 100 to get 46 again. We get 46 no matter which way we do the operations. But this middle result here is 4,600. That doesn't mean a whole lot to me. Now this 2 means something to me. This is what 1% of 200 is, but I'm not sure what this means. The one advantage of doing the calculation this way is you don't end up with decimals like I did here. But we are going to be using a calculator, and so decimals shouldn't be any problem for us. So I don't recommend either of these methods. On future pages, I'm not going to show these methods. Now, another kind of calculations to do with percents is finding a percent increase. Here we have a 5% increase on 120 euros. Now the first thing you do is you change 5% into a decimal. The decimal point is not in here, so we know it's behind the 5, and you move it, when you move two places, well, there's no number in this other place, so you have to put a 0 there. Remember, when you changing a percent to a decimal and there's just a single digit here, and there's going to be a 0 in front of it before the decimal. Now the next step to do is you add this to 1, and it means you just put a 1 here and you get 1.05, and we take this 1.05 and multiply it by 120 euros and get 126 euros. This is 120 increased by 5%, and I'll show you in a moment another way of doing this, the way you may have been doing it before, just to convince you that this really is true. Now the old way of doing this was you would first take 5% of 120. Notice I've changed, even though I say it's the old way, I have changed the 5% to a decimal. I multiply it by 120, and not 0.5 times 120. Let's try it out. Not 0.5 times 120 equals 6. Now we want a 5% increase. We don't just want to find 5%, but we want a 5% increase. So we have to take the 6 and add it to the original amount to get 126. Well, what I've done here is I've done the adding before the multiplying. This not 0.5 times 120 gives a 6, and the 1 times 120 keeps 120. It keeps the 120 that we add. So when you multiply by the 1, we get the 120. When you multiply the 0.5, we get the 6, and add together, you get 126. Well, I've done the adding here before I've done the multiplying, and there are some good reasons for doing it this way. It's quicker, and there's some questions you'll see in just a moment that you have to do this way. There's no other way to do them. So let's go on to this next example of 20% off from a certain number. I've taken 240 euros. Suppose some TV set is on sale, end of the year sale, and they're marking 20% off. What would the price be? Well, again, the first thing you do is you take the percent, change it to a decimal, and now since this is a percent off rather than a percent increase, we subtract the 0.20 from 1 to get 0.80. Now, although I say we should calculate in percents, I quite often talk in percents because this is, it's easier to say a percent. This is 80%, and what this means is that after you take 20% off the price, you're going to have 80% of the original price left, and you multiply the 80% written as a decimal times the original price to get 192. So we take 0.8 times 240 and get 192. Oh, now here I have it written out. Now, the old method, we would have first found out how much the reduction was, which is 20% of 240, and that turned out to be 48 euros, and then subtract the reduction from the original price to get 192. But what I've done is I've done the subtraction first, and for later problems there's going to be a good reason for doing it this way. Now, these are different kinds of questions I'm coming into now. Suppose there was a 5% increase and the resulting price was 168, and we want to find out what was the original amount. So again, we change the 5% to 0.5, and we add 1 to the 0.5, and then we take the final price and divide by 1.05 to find the original price was 160. When you want to find the original amount, you find the end percent, which in this case is 105% written as a decimal, and you divide that into the final price to get the original amount. Now in this next example, something is marked 20% off and the resulting price was 60 euros. What's the original price? Again, you change the percent to a decimal. You subtract the decimal from 1 to get 0.8 or 80%. And we divide the final price by the percent written as a decimal to find the original price was 75 euros. Now here's another type of percent question. I just want to go back to this question here. These questions of finding the original amount by first subtracting or adding the percent change from 1 and then dividing by this number here, which is saying that the final price is 80% of the original price, and then you divide the final price by 80% to get the original price. There is no other easy way of doing this kind of question of finding the original amount. So to find the original amount, you have to find out what percent the final price is of the original amount, and then divide by that percent written as a decimal. Okay, now go on to this final kind of question that comes up with percent, and it is compound interest. Suppose you put 300 euros in the bank at 3% interest per year for 5 years. How much would this money be worth after 5 years? So again, we change 3% to a decimal, we add 1 and we get 1.03. And now, after 1 year, you multiply 300 by 1.03 to find out how much money is in the account after 1 year. After the second year, you're going to get 3% interest on the amount that was in the account after 1 year. So you're going to multiply by 1.03 again. In the third year, you multiply, it increases 3% again of what you had after 2 years, and this happens 5 times. And an abbreviated way of writing when you multiply the number by itself 5 times is to write a little 5 at the end of the number and raised up. And this number written like this is called an exponent or a power, and this is read 1.03 to the 5th power, and you multiply that by 300 and it turns out to be this number here. I will do it on the calculator. I'm first going to do this calculation here, 1.03. Didn't take the O, so I have to try this again. 1.03. Uh, had to pause the recorder because the calculator didn't seem to be working for me. I think it's working now. 1.03. I'm going to raise that to the fifth power. I use this button here, X, and this arrow pointing up, and Y, it means this Y is going to be up higher. So I press that, and then I press 5, and equals, and that's what this number is here, and I want to multiply that by 300. And I get this number here. I have to round off to the nearest cent. The number after the 8 is smaller than 5, so I just drop the rest of those numbers. Now, there's a formula for doing this kind of process, which I'm showing here. The value of the account is equal to the initial principal, P, initial amount you put in is called the principal, times, and I put in brackets because I want to add 1 to the rate. The rate is not 0.03, and then you raise this expression to the power of the number of years, in this case was 5. Now we can also write that formula with the rate as a percent, and this formula looks very much like this, except I used a uppercase R to indicate percent is 3, and then it has to be divided by 100. That will turn it into not 0.03, and that's raised to the power of the number of years. But this is one reason why we like to use decimals in formulas rather than percents, is because it makes the formulas a little easier to read and to write. And in algebra and math and finance and science and mathematics, you'll come across a lot of formulas, and the formulas are easier to work with when the fraction is written as a decimal and not a percent. Because if it is a percent, you have to convert it back to the decimal anyway. So instead of putting the number in your formula as a percent, we just write them, know that the number that you put into your formula should be a decimal. All right, so how did your answers compare to mine?